It took us 9 weeks to do the story of Shimshon, and it took us the best part of 4 hours to do Kol Nidre. So to do Unetane Tokef and to do it justice in 45 minutes is going to be a bit tricky for me, because my particular style is to do things very analytically and slowly, but I shall do my best.
Johnny, just to tell you, the 45 minutes is not a hard boundary, and you're welcome to go on a little longer if you want. There's nothing holy about 45 minutes.
Okay, thank you for that. Well, I think we'll probably will do that. We'll go on as long as people are interested. The beauty of Zoom, of course, is you can sneak off without anybody knowing, and you don't need to feel embarrassed about it. Generally speaking, when we do our Zoom Shiurim, we have questions as we go along, but I don't think that's really going to be feasible with over 50 participants. So I'd ask you to hang on to your questions until the end, if you can, and then hopefully we'll leave some time for discussion and questions and see where we go to. So, Unetane Tokef, let's get straight into our subject matter. I'm going to share my screen with you, which hopefully will have the text on it very shortly. Okay, there we go. Please just give me a thumbs up, somebody, if you can see that screen. Okay, good. Thank you. Right. Yep. So here we go. Unetane Tokef. You'll all be familiar with this prayer. It sits in the main part of the Musaf service, immediately before Kedusha of Musaf on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur in the Ashkenazi service. Sephardim only say it on Rosh Hashanah, not on Yom Kippur. But we are going to deal with the Ashkenazi ideas, because there is a great deal of history connected with Unetane Tokef, which really sits well and finds basis really in the Ashkenazi communities, the real Ashkenazi communities of the Rhineland. So before we go any further, let's just, before we actually get into the nitty-gritty of the text, let's talk a little bit about the origin of Unetane Tokef. Many of you will be very familiar with the famous story of Rabbi Amnon of Mainz. Mainz is a community in the Rhineland, right in the heart of Ashkenazi Jewry. In the circa the 11th century, this is a story which is very familiar to many people. It was a story that was told to me when I was a small child at Jewish day school in Prestwich. And I remember having nightmares about it for many, many days between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. And actually thinking about it, it was a bit of a gruesome story to be telling young children. But then I thought a bit more about it. And actually, we tell a lot of gruesome stories to our young children in our folklore. And perhaps that's another subject for another day. But the story which you'll all be familiar with, I think, is the story of Rav Amnon, who is said to have been asked by the local governor, Christian governor, to consider converting from Judaism to Christianity. And this is the time we have to understand the historical background here is very important. This is said to take place around the 11th, 12th century, at the time of the Crusades. The Crusades, of course, were a time of great trouble for the Jewish community, particularly the Jewish community of the Rhineland, which is where many of these Crusades took hold, and certainly where many of the massacres took place, which were as responsible but from the Crusaders. Rav Amnon was asked to consider converting to Christianity, and he decided to play for time. And he said, I tell you what, Governor, give me 3 days to think about it, and then I'll give you my answer. And of course, he went home and immediately felt dreadful, had charata, regretted even giving the idea that he would consider converting. And he went back to the palace, to the governor's house eventually, and he said to him, absolutely not, no way. And in fact, it was a terrible thing of me to even give you any idea that I should convert, and my tongue should be cut out as a punishment for saying such a dreadful thing that I would even think about it. And the governor said, no, it's not your tongue that should be cut out. It should be your legs that should be cut off, because you didn't come back to me when you should have done. I had to go and call for you. And so they cut off his legs and they cut off his arms, and they sent him back home, presumably on a stretcher with his limbs next to him. And of course, he was very poorly and eventually died. But before he died, he asked to be carried into shul, and he recited the Unetane Tokef prayer. 3 days later, after he had died, the story is that he appeared in a dream to Rav Kolonimus ben Meshulam, a famous rabbi of the time, and he taught him the text of Unetane Tokef and asked Rav Kolonimus to make sure that this prayer was disseminated to all the congregations in the diaspora, and that it should be inserted into the tefillot for the Yamim Noraim. And that was a story that was a very famous story. The first time that story appears is in the 13th century. It appears in the one of the machzorim then of the 13th century with that story. So the story itself is very, very ancient. And if you look in any of your English machzorim, I remember as a kid, I had the Birnbaum machzor, which was given to me when it first came out in the late 60s. And I remember reading this story in the Birnbaum machzor. It's certainly in the Art Scroll machzor, and it's in the Corinne Sachs Machzor as well. It's a very famous story. And if you ask many, many people about Unetane Tokef, they will tell you that this prayer was written by Rav Amnon of Mainz in the 10th, 11th century. The only problem is that that isn't true. Now, how do we know that that's not true? Because there is something called the Cairo Geniza. The Cairo Geniza is a collection of documents dating from as far back as the 7th century up to the 19th century, or 18th century, I think. And it is a collection of hundreds of thousands of fragments of documents which were found. The first people to really get interested in the Cairo Geniza was in the 18th century. And over the past 150, 200 years, more and more of the documents in the Cairo Geniza have been examined. And one of the documents that was found was a manuscript copy of the prayer of Unetane Tokef. And with the documents in the Cairo Geniza, they dated all their documents on the basis of the kind of material that it was written on. So they were able to date the various documents to fairly accurate time periods based on the kind of writing, the kind of ink, and the kind of paper or parchment or whatever it was that was written on. And the this copy of the Unetane Tokef was dated from the Cairo Geniza, was dated to somewhere about the 8th century, 8th, 9th century, this particular manuscript. Now that, of course, is several hundred years before the story of Rav Amnon of Mainz. So therefore, it can't be the case that Rav Amnon wrote Unetane Tokef. In addition to that, there's something a little bit odd about the story of Rav Amnon. Rav Amnon of Mainz is said to have lived around about the same sort of time period as Rashi. Now, if Rav Amnon of Mainz was such a big tzaddik and such a major rabbi of that time, we would expect to have found some information about
Johnny, we lost you. Anybody hear him? Nod your heads. Can you hear him?
He's frozen. Can't hear.
Johnny, you're frozen.
No. He's gone. No.
Johnny has zoomed out. Avril, can you call him? You have his phone number?
He's gone.
Well, we all know there's a problem with the Zoom.
We can't hear Avril either. She's muted. She's saying something, but I don't know what.
On the phone, your trader picture is back.
We're gone.
Oh, here he comes. He's...
Hello, I'm back.
We lost you.
I don't know what happened there. I think we had an internet crash.
Yeah.
Anyway, where were we? Yes, so we had to ask the question, who wrote Unetane Tokef? Why did the story of Rav Amnon take such a hold on the imagination of the Jewish people? And does it matter that Rav Amnon didn't really write it? So I would like to suggest to you that the first question seems to be answered by many people, that it was seems to have been written by a man called Rav Yanai, who was a prolific author and paitan, a poet who lived in Israel. And that's important, as you'll see in a moment, that he lived in Israel around about the 7th century, and it is thought now, following the discovery of the Cairo Geniza, that this was actually written, Unetane Tokef was written by Rav Yana. Now, the second question is, why did this story of Rav Amnon really take hold? And in order to understand that, we have to understand what was going on at that time. And as I said before, this was a time of the Crusades. It was a time when Jewish communities were being massacred. It was a time where there was no good news whatsoever. People were giving up their lives for their beliefs. They were being told that they had to convert to Christianity by the Crusaders, or else they would be put to death. And many Jews allowed themselves to be killed rather than to convert. Some families even killed their own families rather than have their families convert. And some communities in totality committed suicide, a bit like the Masada story, to avoid mass conversion. It was a shocking time. You only have to read accounts of the Crusades. If you want to hear Jewish accounts of it, have a look in the art scroll, Kinot's book for Tisha B'Av. There are various Kinot there translated with notes about the Crusades and what was going on. It was a horrendous, horrendous time. It was, as it were, the Holocaust of that generation. And Rav Amnon is now thought to be, by many people, actually a montage, almost a collage of various different people around that time, all sort of brought together under the personalization of Rav Amnon, who was to personify the Jew of the Crusades. And he was to personify him in the fact that they were under such terrible pressure to convert that they would even momentarily, in a moment of weakness, give the impression that they might even think about it. But Rav Amnon, of course, also personified that strength of the Jew who realized that this was not something that could be contemplated and was willing to martyr himself in order to maintain his faith. And at that point, we see this, the elevation of the Jewish soul to the highest possible level. We're told, of course, that in the Rambam makes it very clear in his Mishneh Torah that one has to transgress any of the 613 commandments on pain of death, except for three, which are, of course, idol worship, which is conversion, shvichat damim, murder, and sexual immorality. So the ideal, and we know of we read it again, we read it even on Yom Kippur in the afternoon, of the Asara Harugi Malchut, the 10 martyrs, Rabbi Akiva being one of them. Rabbi Akiva was the one who understood at the time of his death that he was able to fulfill the mitzvah of v'chol nafshecha, ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokech v'chol ma'adev v'chol nafshecha, meaning his whole soul, to give up his life. This was the highest level that a Jew could reach. And Rav Amnon personified that position of the Jew, that he reaches that level of holiness that he would be even willing to martyr himself as a result of this holy level that he reaches in his service of Hashem. And of course, this prayer of Unetane Tokef is immediately before the Kedusha, the holy part, the Kedusha, the most holy part of the Musaf service. So this is the height of the holiness of a Jew. And Rav Amnon's martyrdom in this story personifies that. And I think it's therefore clear that the reason that Rav Amnon's story was so eagerly accepted by the Jewish people was because of the level of holiness that it reaches at this point. So the third question I want to ask is, does it matter that Rav Amnon didn't write it? And of course, the answer is no, it doesn't really matter who wrote it. Rav Amnon is associated with this prayer. And many people, as I've said, don't even believe that Rav Amnon was a single individual person. But Rav Amnon is associated with this because of the significance of that particular prayer at that particular time of history. And in order to understand that, we have to look at the prayer itself. I don't know whether you can still see my screen. I suspect not, since we got cut off. Give me a, no, you can't. Okay, let me try and share again. Give me a nod or a thumbs up if you can see the screen, please.
Okay. That's good, it's good.
Okay, so the prayer is basically split up into sections. And let's just go through these sections briefly and see what the prayer is all about. Unetane Tokef Kedushat Hayom. Right away at the beginning of the prayer, we are told about the holiness of the day. Unetane Tokef, let's give a power to the holiness of the day. By the way, just as those of you who come to my shiurim regularly will know that I like to point out bits of ancient Hebrew that fit in with modern Hebrew. There's a word, tokef. I'm sure you've all been asked on the phone for the tokef of your credit card. okay? When they ask you for your tokef, what they mean is the expiry date. And how does that fit in with over here? Our translation here in Safaria is Unetane, let us give from Notain, tokef, power. Well, your credit card has only got power until its expiry date. Once its expiry date's gone, it has no power. So tokef in modern Hebrew, in use with credit cards, means the expiry date, but really it means here, it means the power. Let's talk about the power of the holiness of the day. Straight away, this is telling us that this is a powerful, holy day. Ki hu nora v'ayom. It is nora. It is awesome. That word awesome, which has been devalued so much in modern society. If you speak to many young people, especially of the American variety, they will tell you that the thing is awesome, when actually it's not really awesome at all. What is awesome is the power of God. Ayom is terrible. The word ayom means terrible in its original form of the word terrible, which would fill you with terror. We use the modern word terrible to mean bad, but the original word terrible means full of terror. So imagine that you are stood in front of the holy Kisei HaKavod, the holy throne of glory. Imagine how terror-struck we would be and how awesome it would be to us. That is what Nora V'ayom means. It is the real truth of those words. These are words in their original form before they've had inflation applied to them to the 21st century. Hashem is sitting on the throne be'emet, with truth. Now, this is a bit of a problem. Those of you who have been attending the Gemara Sanhedrin Shia will know that we have spent a long time discussing the idea of three concepts: emet, truth, mishpat, judgment, and tzedek, righteousness or charity or whatever however you translate that word. Emet is truth and implies that there is no fudging here. There's no getting away from stuff. God is sitting on his throne in truth. This is it as it is. There's no fibs. There's no lies. There's no fudging it. This is it. We are here in front of the Kisei HaKavod. And of course, we then say the attributes of God. He's the one that judges us. It's actually an interesting concept here, because if you look at this, we have something which only God can do. Emet ki atahu dayan u'mochiach v'yodea v'aid. Here, God is the judge, he is the Dayan, and he's also the aid. He's also the witness. Now, in an earthly court, the witness is not the judge. The witnesses are supposedly independent, and the judge is the one doing the judging. Here, God is the judge and the witness. How is he the witness? Because he is sitting in Emet. He is the one that knows the Emet. So he is the witness to our actions. And then we have this idea, v'tiftach et sefer hazichronot. The book of records is opened. U'mei elav yikarei. Now it's translated here as, and from it all shall be read. And now I don't think that's a very good translation. If it was from it, it would be u'mimenu yikare, it would be read. Here is umei elav. Something which is umei elav means on its own. And I'm not sure how the Machzorim translate. I've got the Korin Sachs here in front of me. I'm just seeing how they translate it. Let's have a look. Yes, the Korin Sachs translates it as this. It is read of itself. So the Korin Sachs Machzor translates it more literally, and it reads itself. Now, that means the book is opened, And unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you've been in the last 12 months, one's fate is automatically said in front of you. It speaks itself. It reminds me of the newspapers in the Harry Potter stories that sort of move around and sort of seem to be living newspapers. This is a living book. It's telling our story. This is a book of our story, which is reading itself. Now, what that means to me is that that's my life. That's a video of my life being shown in front of HaKadosh Baruch Hu on this holy day. Now, for me, that is a very frightening thought. That somebody, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, of all people, so to speak, is seeing everything that I have done in that day. Ume'elav yikare. It's automatic. It's there. He's just pressed play, and there I am in all my glory, hopefully, but more likely all my shame for all the things that I have not done correctly. And v'chotem yad kol adam. Everybody's signature is on there. That is, so we're building up this picture. We're building up this picture of a court case where HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself is the judge. We are the defendant. And the evidence is self-evident. The evidence is the Sefer HaZichronot. It's the video of our lives. There's no getting away from this. This is Emet. And this is the position that we find ourselves in immediately before Kedusha on Yom Kippur. And then we have an amazing, what I think is an amazing paradox. Look at this next few words. I don't know if you've ever thought about this. Uva shofar gadol yitaka. And with the great shofar is sounded, you'd expect a great shofar to make a great noise. You'd expect the bigger the shofar, the greater the noise it's going to make. But what do we find? This is weird. Uva shofar gadol yitaka. The great shofar is sounded. V'kol demama daka ishama. A thin, silent voice shall be heard. So this quiet little whisper comes out of the shofar gadol. There's this paradox. On the one hand, we have this enormous, great shofar, which is proclaiming Yom HaDin. And what comes out of it is a little whimper, a kol demama daka. Rabbi Sachs describes this kol demama daka as the internal voice, the shofar gadol yitaka. The great noise that we make in our lives, we go around our lives making big noise. We go around on our lives, perhaps shouting about the big I am. Look what I've done with my life. Aren't I the great guy? Look what I did. But actually, when all is peeled away, there is only left that kol demama daka, that thin whisper of a voice inside us, which is the conscience that we have, the good deeds that we've done, trying to express themselves. So there's this paradox of the outward person, the shofar gadol, to the inward person, this kol demama daka. And then you have umalacha, umalachim yechafezon. There's angels running around. Yechafezon, it's from the word that we have bechipazon. We eat our Korban Pesach, remember, bechipazon, in a hurry. They're rushing around all over the place. Mechil urada, and there's fear and trembling all around. Vayomru, hine yomadin. These are the court angels. The court, those of you who have ever been to court, you have these court clerks that say, "Oh, rise," and the judge walks in, and he's got his shekel on and his old his kittel and everything. And everyone stands up and bows to the judge, and he says, "Yes, sit down." This is the court. This is Vayomru Hine Yom Adin. The court is in session, and so this is the buildup of the Unetane Tokef prayer. We are being tried, and then we come to the next little section within the having set the scene. We set the next section in Unetane Tokef. We come to the real the nitty-gritty. We're into it now. This is what it's all about. Our fate is hanging in the balance. Now, this, when I was a kid, I'm sure many of you will be able to empathize with this view. When I was a kid, this was the bit that really struck home with me. Barosh Hashanah Yeketevon, Uvayom Tzom Kippur Yeketemon. On Rosh Hashanah, it's written down. On Yom Kippur, it's sealed. Kama Ya'avrun, Kama Yibareyun. Who's going to pass away? How many will be created? Mi Yichye, Umi Yamut. No, we get straight to it. There's no build-up now. Who's going to live and who's going to die? This is the crux of everything that we are building up to here, to a crescendo. Who is going to live and who's going to die? Not only that, how are they going to die? Mi Bekitso, who's going to die at his predestined time after 120 years? Umi Lo Bekitso, who sadly is going to die before his time? Mi Bamaim and Mi Ba'esh, Mi Bacherov and Mi Bachaya. All these terrible things. Remember, I asked a question, why was Rav Amnon's story so powerful with Unetane Tokef? Why was it so connected? Remember what was going on in the Crusades. People whose lives were on their line. Who was going to live and who was going to die was not a simple question. In the same way as now we are sitting in this terrible corona crisis, we ask these same questions. Mi ichye, umi amut. Who is going to live and who is going to die? Mi bekitso, mi lo bekitso. Mi bamay, mi baesh. Mi bacherev, mi bachaya, mi barav, mi batzama. Mi vamageifa, look at that one. Who by plague? Who by pandemic? We are present day Rav Amnons. Rav Amnons communities were facing these questions. Those communities in the time of the Crusades were facing existential questions on an individual basis and on a community basis. And you could argue that this is how we are facing today, an existential crisis. Please God, everybody here will stay safe and healthy, and we have to do whatever we can to maintain that. And do whatever we can. But let's face it, we all know, everybody, every single one of us in this Zoom meeting, every single one in your community in North Netanya, in my community here in Poleg, in every Jewish community around the world, and every community around the world, Jewish or not Jewish, there is nobody who doesn't know somebody who has been affected by this pandemic. And that is where we are standing now. We are at Yom Kippur of a present day crisis like that of the Crusades. I don't think that's being over dramatic. And so if we think of Rav Amnon's connection to this prayer, we can see how we should be very connected to this prayer. We have to think of this in the same way as they did. And then we come to, it's almost fatalistic, this part. It's written on Rosh Hashanah, and it's sealed on Yom Kippur. And once it's sealed, well, you're done, aren't you? You've had it, because, you know, it's sealed. Once it's not sealed, you can take it out of the envelope, and you can scrub out what's there, and you can rewrite it. But once it's sealed, you've had it. But that's not true, is it? Because we're also told that HaKadosh Baruch Hu posts it on Hoshana Rabbah. So you've got to Lashana Rabbah, he can still open the envelope and he can still change it. But the fact is, it seems a bit fatalistic, this. Rosh Hashanah, it's written, Yom Kippur, it's sealed, that's it. But then we're told we can turn it on its head, because here, and we all shout this out, don't we? Utshuva utfila utstokam avirin etroag zera. Repentance, prayer and charity can remove the evil decree. So easy. All you have to do, tshuva, tefillah, tzedakah. And then you can, that's not so easy though, is it? So we also have to have an interesting look at this particular bit of tshuva, tefillah, and tzedakah. And where did this come from? Whether it was Yanai, whether it was Rav Amnon, whether it was Rav Kalonimus Ben Meshulam who wrote it, whoever it was that wrote this prayer was had in mind something, which I'm going to show you now from the Gemara. There is a Gemara in Rosh Hashanah, Daf Tet Zayin, Amud Bet. If you want to look it up, it's 16b. Can you see my screen? It should say Rosh Hashanah 16b. Okay, it's over here. I'll read it in the English. Rabbi Yitzchak said, a person's sentence is torn up on account of four types of actions. Remember, four types of actions. These are giving charity, tzedakah, crying out in prayer, tefillah, changing one's name, and changing one's deeds for the better. One's deeds for the better being changed, you could call that teshuvah. So there are four things that the Gemara being written around about the year 500-ish, so the 6th century. So if the scholars who think Yanai wrote this, it wasn't long after the Gemara was written. Yanai was around about the 7th century. So here we've got four different things. We've got four different things. And he quotes Mishle, who also brings the following in Mishle and in Tehillim, in various different places. But the Gemara 6 speaks about four different things. Let's go back to Unetane Tokef. We've only got three. Not only have we only got three, we're missing one. We're missing the change of name. We've also got them in a different order. Let's just have a look at our Gemara again. What does he say? Charity, tzedakah, prayer, tefillah, and tshuva. So tzedakah, tefillah, tshuva. It's quite hard to say that in that order because you're so used to saying tshuva, tefillah, and tzedakah that it's hard to say it the other way around. But the Gemara says tzedakah, tefillah, and tshuva in that order. Now, what's very interesting is that this order has been changed. And in case you think that it wasn't noticed that it was changed and it was just a bit random, I'm going to try and show you a picture from a machzor in the 16th century, a machzor from Salonika in 1522. Let me see if I can show you this. Where's it gone? There we go. Can you see that on the screen? Can you see some Hebrew writing in script? Yeah. Okay. Let me see if I can make the thing a bit bigger. I don't know how to get rid of all that. Can't do it. Anyway, there we go. That's here. Now, this says here, tefillah, tzedakah, tshuva, tefillah, tzedakah. In our normal order, there's the word teshuva, there's the word tefillah, and there's the word tzedakah. And here in the margin, he's got a different order. He's got tefillah, tzedakah, or tshuva. And another manuscript here has got tshuva, tefillah, and tzedakah, like ours, but then it's got tefillah, tzedakah, tshuva. So this, the order seems to be important. We've got tshuva, tefillah, tzedakah. So the Unetane Tokef that we have seems to be slightly different to the version that we've got in the Gemara. And I haven't answered the question yet why the fourth one is missing. The fourth thing that you can do to tear up the decree is to change your name. And the commentators all ask this question of Unetane Tokef. The Gemara in Rosh Hashanah, there it is again, says four things can tear up your sentence. Charity, tefillah, and changing your deeds and also changing your name. So why is changing your name missed out of Unetane Tokef? And many of the commentators suggest that when it says changing your name, it means becoming a different person. When you change your name, you become a different person. The Gemara doesn't talk in any other place about changing your name, tearing up evil decrees. It talks about changing a name, Meshaneh, Shem Meshaneh Mazal. You can change your luck, as it were, by changing a name, which is why when somebody is very ill, we tend to give them a new name so that their Mazal will change. But what it's trying to imply, what the Gemara says, according to the commentators, is that by changing one's name, it's as if you are a completely new person because you have changed the way you behave and you have done teshuva. I actually quite like the idea that that changing one's name is not in Unetane Tokef, because I always had a bit of a problem when I used to see firms that would go bust, ABC Limited, and they would go bust, leaving lots of creditors. And then the next day they would open up as ABC 2020 in brackets Limited. And they just changed their name without actually changing anything about their behavior in the way they did things. So I think the important thing here is the tshuva, tefillah, and staka. So we're given a clue here on how to do this. Now, why is the order that Unetane Tokef put that? The argument is that in order for tefillah, prayer, and staka to work, you have to have done teshuvah first. In other words, you have to have thought about why you're doing these things and the fact that you have returned from your so-called evil ways and now are feeling you want to pray and give charity. I personally, I'd be interested to know what everybody else thinks. I personally think that the order in the Gemara makes more sense. The order in the Gemara is give charity, cry out to prayer, and then you change your deeds. So when you give charity, when you're giving staka, you're giving of yourself to somebody else. And as we all know, that the concept of staka is the one who gives often is the one that receives more than the recipient, because the feeling that one gets when one gives, that one realizes when he's able to give up oneself to somebody less fortunate than oneself, that is something that elevates the soul. There's something inside of us that selem elokim, whether we like it or not, we have it. And when a person does a good thing like giving tzedakah, it's food, it's nourishment for that neshama, for that soul, for that selem elokim, and it is elevated. And you can't help, when you give tzedakah, you cannot help. If you give it in the right way, then you can't help but be elevated. And when you're elevated, you are then encouraged inside of you to pray. What is prayer? Prayer is a primeval cry out to that Father in heaven, that person, that thing, that power, that something that is greater than us, that we bear our soul to, that soul that has just been elevated by the staka, we pray to. There's an expression which is used as in a rather negative way, but I actually don't see it as negative so much, and that is, there are no atheists in a foxhole. And that means that, you know, when you're in trouble, that's when you tend to pray. Well, I think that's pretty normal. I think that's pretty natural human behavior. That when you're in trouble, you go to the depths of your soul and then you pray. And to whom do you pray? You pray to your Father in heaven. You pray to the Selem Elokim, that bit of Elokim that you have that's been elevated. And then when you've done that, then you have the ability to do teshuvah. Teshuvah is not something that comes me'elav of its own, that same word we had before. It's not something that comes on its own. It's something that has to be worked towards. And that's why for me, I personally think that the order that's given in the Gemara is a little bit more logical for my sort of simple mind. But Unetane Tokef we have doesn't really matter, I guess, which order you do it in, as long as you do these things. And what these things do, all three of them, they have a common denominator, and that is that they elevate us. They mean that we are acting not in self-interest. One of the biggest problems of the human being is when we act in self-interest only. And the difference between the human being and, if you like, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the angels in heaven are that they don't have self-interest. And we have to elevate ourselves. Now, giving tzedakah, you are giving of yourself. You're elevating that soul. Tefillah does the same thing. You're recognizing that you need help from above. You want to pray so that your soul is elevated. And that brings you to a true teshuvah. Teshuvah means to return. What are we returning to? We're returning to that pure state that we had before our soul was sullied by living in the world that we live in. It's hard to live in a world here and be pure, which is why some people take the choice to lock themselves away in ivory towers and not be affected by the world. But we, generally speaking, don't do that, and it's difficult. So we have to elevate our souls. And this leads us then into the final section here. We speak about the fact that God is the one that understands us. We say to God, look, you know what we're like. You know what we are. We're basar v'dam. We're flesh and blood. How do you know that? You made us, for goodness sake. You have to recognize that we are only human. And not only are we only human, look at what we are. And we then say, well, for me, is the most poignant and the most powerful part of the Unetane Tokef prayer. For this, for me, this is even more powerful than mi yichye u mi yamut. This is Adam yisodo me'afar v'sofo le'afar. We come from dust, and that's where we're going. Benafsho yavi lachmo. We have to bring our bread, we make our living, but nafsho, we have to put our soul in it. It's hard work. We are told we got kicked out of Gan Eden and we had to work for a living. That we work for a living, we sweat of our brow. Mashul, this is what we're like. And this is the powerful, powerful imagery. Kecheres hanishbar, we're like a broken shard. We're like a bit of pottery that's broken. A bit of pottery. We're a broken thing. Why are we so broken? Because we realize that we are not complete. We are not the way we should be. Kichatzir yavesh. We're like dried out grass. This is the time. This is the time when as you get older, you realize that you're not in the first flush of youth. We are kichatzir yavesh. We're beginning to get a bit dried out. Kitzitz novel. We're like a withered flower. We were once like a flower, beautiful, pure flower, and now we're withered. Why are we withered? Because we've sullied ourselves with our averot. Ketzel over, we're like a passing shadow, a shadow that passes. We see a shadow, we're stood in the Schwitz outside for davening these days, and if you're not fortunate enough to be under the shade, you go and find a bit of shade under a tree, and the sun moves, and before you know it, that shadow's gone, that shade's gone, that beautiful cooling shade. It's only very transitory. Ke'anan kala, it's like a cloud that moves away. There, first of all, you see it, and then it's gone. Ch'ruach noshabet, a wind that just blows temporarily. Ch'avak poreach, dust that scatters in the air, and then the most powerful of all, kachalom ya'uf. It's like a dream. We human beings, our lives are like a dream, ya'uf, from the same word as off, that flies away. I'm sure you've all, at some point in your life, woken up from a beautiful dream whatever your dream was, that beautiful dream that where you were in that wonderful situation. For me, I was at Lourdes. I was on 99, and I've just been bowled a long hop outside leg stump, and I'm ready to bash it to the boundary and get my 100 at Lourdes. And what happens? I'm on 99, and I wake up, and I want to grab that dream back, but it's flown away. There's nothing I can do to get that dream back. I want to get back in that moment. I want to be there again in that dream. And I want that dream to be fulfilled, but I can't because it's flown away. And that is the imagery that the author of Unetane Tokef leaves us with, that our lives are so fleeting and so, if you like, fragile. And at the time when we're standing in front of Hashem and we're saying, this is it, this is the judgment, Emmet, who's going to live, who's going to die? Communities of the Rhineland were facing massacre. Rav Amnon comes into shul and he says this prayer. Imagine the power that that had. And the last few words, V'atahu melech el chai v'kayam. You are the living God. We accept that you are the most powerful of all. We are just a fleeting dream. And at every juncture in history, this prayer has been central to the Jewish people. Sadly, for very much of our history, we have been in situations of persecution where we've been facing these questions of mi ichye umi yamut, who is going to live and who is going to die. And it's very, very powerful. And this is how Rav Amnon's story came to be associated with Unetane Tokef. But it means, what this means is that Unetane Tokef is a timeless prayer. Now, I can't see everybody on my screen, but I can see many of you, and I can see that many of you, I assume probably most of you, because I'm speaking in English, and this is an English speakers forum, I guess. Most of you have come from Chutz La'aretz. And most of you, I think, will probably have made Aliyah in your adulthood rather than your childhood. And many of you, like me, will have made your Aliyah in later adulthood. And therefore, your memories of Unetane Tokef will be different to the Unetane Tokef that you might be used to see having heard when you are in Israel. And I just want to show you and help you understand the timelessness of this Unetane Tokef prayer. I'm going to take you back now to your communities in Chutz La'aretz, and I'd like you to close your eyes, or no, not necessarily close your eyes, because there's a video that goes with it, and listen to this and be taken back perhaps to your youth, perhaps to your young adulthood. Let me share with you, I hope you're going to be able to hear this. Let me know if you can't. This is what I call an old-fashioned Chutz La'aretz Unetane Tokef from Chazan Chaim Adler. Please give me a thumbs up if you can't.
Unetane Tokef Kedushas Hayoyim Ki Unayad Rabe Ayoyim Uvois Inosei Malech Usecha ויקוין בחסד כיסך ותשב עלו ושב עלו Yeah.
I think you'll understand what I mean when I say that was very much a galut version of Unetane Tokef. You could hear the crying, you could hear the sobbing in his voice. You can almost imagine the downtrodden people with their heads down and their feeling of hopelessness almost throughout many, many generations of the diaspora. And they're praying to God for their lives using the Unetane Tokef. That piece by Chazon Adler, to me, very much personified my youth that I used to hear, and I'm sure many of you will probably feel the same. The next piece that I'm going to play for you will be even more familiar to you. And this is also the same tune that we will be used to, certainly from every community that I ever went to in England, and I suspect in America and other English-speaking places as well. This is Cantor Moshe Stern, and have a listen to this. Could see many of you nodding along there. Some of you were singing along, and I can see that. excuse me. Many of you were indeed taken back to your youth, your childhood, your young adulthood, and of course, that's the haunting tune that we all got used to. I arrived here. I think I had my first Yom Kippur here maybe 10 years ago, something like that. And I was waiting for Unetane Tokef, and it didn't come. I didn't get anything like that. I was waiting for this kvetchy, cryy, pleading with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Where was it? And instead, this is what I got.
Unetane Tokef Kedushat Hayom Kihu Nora Ve'ayom Vot Inase Malchutecha Rikol Bechesed Kisecha Re'eshem Alav Be'emet אמת כי אתה הוא דיין מוכיע ויודע ואין וסותד וחותם וסופר ומונה ותזכור כל הנשכחות ותפתח את ספר הזיכרונות
Johnny, do you know the man
who veshofar gadol itaka v'kol demama daka ishama
Johnny, can I just interrupt you 1 second? The man in the white shirt in that video, you know who he is? He's Brigadier General Avigdor Kahalani, who was commander of the 7th Armored Brigade in the Yom Kippur War.
Thank you. I was coming to that. Okay, so that's what I got. Instead of the Chazan Adler version and the Moshe Stern version that we all recognize, that is what we got, a totally different. And I found it very difficult the first couple of years that I was here because I couldn't relate to that, because what I related to are the earlier versions I showed you. But the pictures that went with that video, of course, were from the Yom Kippur War. And this Unetane Tokef to Israelis, that version, that tune of Unetane Tokef means to them the Yom Kippur War. Those people that you saw, as Philip said, these were veterans of the Yom Kippur War. The pictures that you saw were from the Yom Kippur War. The Brigadier General was at the a memorial for those who lost their lives in the Yom Kippur War. This Unetane Tokef is for them. This is their Rav Amnon of Mainz. This is what it means to them. We who weren't in the Yom Kippur War, we who weren't in shul that Yom Kippur and got schlepped out off to the battlefront, we can't really relate to that. But when we see what I just showed you and we hear the chazan of the IDF, Shai Abramson, singing that so beautifully, when you hear that tune, on Monday, That's what you have to have in your mind. We are, it's a different tune for a different time. And it, to me, this is what the Unetane Tokef prayer is all about. It's a timeless prayer. Now, when I was preparing for this, and I'm going to finish with this because we run over time as usual. When I was preparing for this shiur, I came across something which, to me, absolutely sealed the deal, which showed me how powerful Unetane Tokef is for every single generation, for every person, not just every Jew, but every person in the world, and how it has affected, the concept has affected so many people. And I'm going to play you something now, which when I first heard this, which was only yesterday when I was finishing off preparing this, absolutely blew me away. I'm going to play you, first of all, a guitar intro to the thing. And I want you to listen carefully to the background feel of the guitar intro. And then I'm going to switch to another video because the other video, the second video, gives you the lyrics of the song that I'm playing for you. So first of all, I'm going to play you the guitar song, the guitar intro.
Who by accident, who in solitude? mirror, who by his latest command, who by his own hand, who in mortal chains, who in power, and who shall I say is calling?
Powerful. Who by fire? Who by water? Leonard Cohen there, who, as Brian has written there in his message, was a very, very spiritual person. Rabbi Jonathan Sacks was a great fan of Leonard Cohen's, and often quotes him in his writings. He's taken the Unetane Tokef, and he has given it his own modern meaning. Leonard Cohen has taken that, and look at those lyrics. Who by barbiturate, who by powder, is clearly talking about people who sadly overdose. Who by greed, who by hunger. This is his modern take on Unetane Tokef. We have here that range of things that I've shown you, the videos. We started with Chaim Adler, if you like, our childhood version, our old-fashioned galut version of Unetane Tokef, that version of centuries of persecution, centuries of crying out to God at our time of distress, through to the Yom Kippur War, where you've got that much more upbeat melody, which all the Israelis are familiar with, that they relate to the Yom Kippur War. They relate to that terrible time when they were facing an existential threat, all the way through to Leonard Cohen, who's written a modern version of the Unetane Tokef prayer and given it such power. So what I want to leave you with is this message. Unetane Tokef doesn't matter whether it was written by Rev Amnon, or it was written by Yanai, or it was written by Rev Clonimus, or if it was written by Leonard Cohen, it really doesn't matter. Unetane Tokef belongs to the Jewish people. It belongs in the middle of Musaf, of the holiest day of the year, because it is a prayer to which every single one of us can relate in our own way. And the secret of that prayer is its timelessness, its connection to the Jewish soul, and those three important things, Teshuvah, Tefillah, and Tzedakah. All of those things which feed the soul, that music feeds the soul. The entire prayer of Unetane Tokef feeds the soul. The fact that our brave soldiers went out there, lost their lives, some of them sadly, and others who fought so bravely in the Yom Kippur War, so that we can sit here in Netanya and have a Yom Kippur, not the kind of Yom Kippur we want because we're full of Corona restrictions, but nevertheless, we are here because of their sacrifice. We are here because of the previous generation's sacrifice. We are here because of Rav Amnon's sacrifice. We're here because of the Crusader Kehilot, the congregations, the Kehilot in the Crusader times stood up for what they believed. And what we have to do is we have to do, in some ways, what Leonard Cohen has done, and take that prayer, personalize it, make it something that meaningful for us. And then at the end of that, Be'ezrat Hashem, ma'avirin etz ruach ha'gezerah. Anyway, that God forbid we should have bad decrees, should go. And the answer, mi yichyeh u'mi yamut, should be kulam yichyu. We should all live, we should all survive this existential threat that we have and come out of it the other side better people. Shavua tov, gemar chatima tova. I'm happy to discuss, to answer, to hear anybody else's comments, anybody who wants to stay and talk. I'm very happy to hang on. All of those of you that are going, I wish you a tzom kal. I wish you a gemar chatima tova and shavua tov.
Hey, Rabbi Lieberman, so thank you very much. Anybody would like to raise any points? Just unmute yourself. Okay. One at a time, please. Anybody want to start off? Just raise your hand and then I know who it is. Anybody want to say something? Okay, Rowena or Graham, go ahead. Oh, no, you were just clapping. I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah, you were clapping. Maurice Pico, go ahead, yes. Please.
Okay, what I learned from a rabbi here in Israel many years ago, you can hear me, right?
Yes, you're fine.
Okay. The whole idea is not that it eliminates the Gezrata Din, but by the tshuva, charity, repentance, everything that you do lessens the severity of the Gezrata Din. And that's what people need to be aware of. That's one of the main essences of the message of the Unetane Tokef.
Yeah, I mean, the idea that we have is to, I think somewhat simplistically, when we're kids, we sort of get the idea that we can wipe the slate clean and start all over afresh. And I think what you're saying, Maurice, is that we never really get a chance to fully wipe the slate clean, but we can actually lessen the power of what we've done in the past. And I think that's probably true because I was talking about this to somebody today, actually. We are definitely the products of our past. We can't undo our past. What we can do is going forward, we can actually try and make that the things that we do more inspired for the future and perhaps lessen the effects of some of the things we might have done not quite so good in the past. So I think I would agree with that.
Any other questions? Okay, Hazel or Jack, go ahead.
May I please? Hi, Rabbi. Shavuot Tov, everybody. It was absolutely brilliant tonight. It's not so much a question as of what I was thinking along with you, because I remember vividly in our little shul in Dublin, when Unetane Tokef was given out, the person that got to open the ark, and that applies to me in Leeds as well, it really had to be somebody very special to, these are my memories of getting Unetane Tokef. Wow, you must have done something good this year, or whatever. But the point was, my parents, their handkerchiefs were sopping wet from crying out at Unetane Tokef. It was so much instilled into us that the melodies are quite haunting. Although I must admit to you that when I go to the kibbutz where my children live, then we have the more modern type of music and I can adapt to it all. I feel as if I'm with them, and that's just me personally. I did make a note here, and I must tell you, I put down, it's a timeless prayer. So we agree on something there. Also, you know, with the changing of the name, some people had no choice, because when they got to England, they didn't understand what their names were. So Mr. Schuster became a shoe, Mr. Schneider became a tailor. These are all different things which have happened to us. But I don't think that that would apply to them not being the same person. And my other one was, of course, today's Parsha in the Ha'azinu. It talks about the dew on the grass. And I looked at that and I used to think of my children's service, of my little young children there saying, when we water the grass, you young children, you will grow. You will grow strong. And Ha'azinu is a very great, lovely sedra for that type of thing to put over. And finally, if I may say, that when I was taking my children's service in Leeds, they loved the story of Rabbi Maimon because it was great. It was cruel. I mean, the children are like that, you know. But what does it matter? You're quite right, Rabbi. Whoever wrote it, it was ingenious. And long, long may it continue. Thank you for the choice.
Thank you, Hazel. Firstly, I'd like to say that it's lovely to see you, even if it's only just the top of your head that I can see.
Sorry.
But it's lovely to see you, and I'm delighted that I agree with you. I just want to say something about, you mentioned something about opening the ark.
Yeah.
And this is a story. I'm going to tell you a very quick story. This is a story that is a warning, if you like, but for every gabbai of the shul. I don't know if I'm the gabbai of our shul, so it's a warning for me. I don't know if the gabbai of your shul, David, is with us here tonight.
Yeah, David.
It's me. It's okay. It's me.
Okay. Right, David, listen carefully to this story, because this yes. happened. This happened to my father. My father, Zichrono Livracha, was of the same generation as Hazel, and they were, in fact, good friends. My father was also of the same idea that the person who was given the honor of opening the ark for Unetane Tokef, that was the greatest honor that you could get, to be opening the ark for Unetane Tokef, closely followed by Ne'ilah. But Unetane Tokef, that was the thing. And this particular year, the Gabbai said to him before Yom Kippur that this year they were honoring my father for Unetane Tokef. And my father was not in any way a person who sought after honor at all. He was not like that, but he was absolutely made up. He was so chuffed that he was going to get Unetane Tokef if it really meant something important to him. Anyway, come the day, the Gabbai told the Untergabbai to go and get the person for Unetane Tokef, and he made a mistake and he went and got somebody else.
Ivan.
He didn't give it to my father. Well, my father was absolutely upset. I didn't say anything to the guy, but, you know, he was very upset. And he came to him afterwards and he apologized and he said, you know, it was a mistake. The fellow got mixed up, but whatever it was. And he says, don't worry. I promise you, next year you'll have it. Unfortunately, there wasn't a next year. And my father passed away before the next opportunity, and he never got an opportunity to open the ark for Unetane Tokef. And I think I saw Jeffrey Glasky join before. He's not on my screen now, but I think I saw him. When Jeffrey came to Poleg, that particular year, the Gabbai, it wasn't me, came to me and wanted to give me Unetane Tokef to open the ark. And I passed it over to Jeffrey because Jeffrey's my first cousin. And I passed it over to Jeffrey. He was the senior one of the family. And I said to Jeffrey, this is yours, Jeffrey. And now you're standing in the place of my father because he didn't have that. And that sort of completed the circle. It's a message for all the Gabbaim. Be careful. Don't make any mistakes because there might not be an opportunity to correct your mistake. So the opening the ark for Unetane Tokef is a highlight of the service. And yes, you have to choose very carefully. Thank you, Hazel, for raising that and for giving me the opportunity to tell that little story.
Thank you.
Every Gabbai's nightmare, you just told us. Anybody else? Any other questions or points? Anybody?
David, can you hear me? Sorry.
Philip. No, who is it? Michael Ordman.
Yeah, sorry.
Michael Ordman first.
If you can hear me, yeah. No, yes. It's just on the thing the Rabbi Lieberman said about the sequence of the Teshuvah, Tefillah, Tzedakah was quite interesting, but because part of that, the charity Tzedakah itself, In Jewish law, I think we don't consider that to be like giving charity as such. It's something that we have to do as part of our religion. It's not sort of like, oh, you know, give more charity, you get better reward for it or something in heaven or something like that. It is part of our, I think. And also tefillah isn't it a substitute for the korbanot that we had to give, and we would do that if we made a sin. So it's almost like we had to do that, and therefore it's the most difficult thing is teshuvah, which, you know, how could you do teshuvah? That's the hard thing. So is it put at the front because that is the hardest thing, or should we leave it to the last because it is the thing you do after all the things that you have to do, and it's the most difficult one to do, so you leave it to the last?
Okay, either of those arguments would work, wouldn't they? And that's very well thought through. If I could just answer your question by having a look at the Machzor itself. Now, I don't know whether you've got it in Yes, it's in the Koran stacks. I haven't got an art scroll in front of me, but in the Koran stacks, and certainly in most Mahzorim, over the word teshuvah, you have the word tsom, which means fast. Over the word tefillah, you have the word kol, which means voice, prayer, voice. And over the word tzedakah, you have the word mamon, which means money. Now, I didn't really know what those extra little words were for. I thought they were just trying to explain to me what teshuvah, tefillah, and tzedakah is. Tzedakah means money. Tefillah means you've got to say your prayers. And teshuvah, part of the teshuvah process, is the fasting, which I'm sure that's what it's there for. But now I'm going to invite you to work out the gematria, the numerical value of each of those words. And I'll save you the trouble because they all add up to 136. Each of those three words, som, kol, and mamon, adds up to 136. It's the same gematria for each of them. And what that is teaching us, Michael, is that they are all equally important. And you could say, in some ways, they're all equally difficult. And what I mean by that is that some people will find tefillah very easy, and some people will find it very difficult. Some people will find giving charity very easy. Other people will find it more difficult. Same way as tshuva, the typical tshuva we're talking about is leaving a sin, as Rambam talks about, azivat hachet, abandoning that particular sin. Let's take one that we all do, lashon hara. We all speak it. There's nobody that doesn't do it, except for my wife. And it's some for some people, it's very hard. For other people, it's not as hard. So what these little words and their gematria are perhaps telling us is that for some, this is more important or more difficult, and for others, it's other thing. It's the combination. And in some ways, this tsom, kol, and mamon is giving us an indication that whichever it is that we find that we have to do the hardest work on, that's the one that we have to work on hardest. And so I think those three words with the same gematria gives us a little clue to that idea there.
Okay, thank you. Philip, go ahead.
I'm just curious. My dad, Oliver Shalom, was a very well-known baltfiller in London. Has anybody ever heard this? You know, talking about Chazoni before, it goes like this. Barosh Hashanah Ikosevun Of Yom Tov Kippur Yechosemun.
Yes, I've heard that.
My dad used to sing that for Unetane Tokef, Barosh Hashanah. Ah, you knew it, Johnny. You knew this.
Yes, I did. That's yes, I've heard that. And I even recognize it from your lousy singing, Philip.
Okay. Any more?
Yes, please.
Who's that?
Vivian.
Vivian, go ahead, Vivian.
Hello. First of all, Johnny, a huge thank you. That was amazing and very inspiring. Brilliant. My question relates to the fourth area that you talked about, changing your name. I see that almost as trying to change your reputation, which is a very hard thing to do, because even when we forget who we are, other people around us remind us very quickly of who we are and what we came from, and how to keep our place. And we're told that a good name is the greatest thing that we can take with us at our end of days. So I thought that was a really interesting.
I think that's very interesting. Just to take the first point there about reputation. It's very easy to obtain a bad reputation. It's very difficult to undo that bad reputation when you've got it. And that, I think, is perhaps the idea of this this Gemara that talks about the four things, changing one's name and changing one's deeds, they go together. What you're saying, I think, if I understand you, and I think it's a beautiful idea, is that we, the onlookers, as it were, should allow people who have changed their deeds to undo their reputations. I mean, it's very hard. I could mention you any number of names, and the misdeed that this particular person did so ever many years ago will come popping into your head, because that's the way we are. And perhaps this is teaching us, for the onlooker, not just the person, why'd you change your name? I know what my name is, but I've changed my name because actually I've changed the person who I am. And it's a bit like, if you're, I don't know, I've only just thought of this, somebody getting married under the chuppah, it's like they're reborn again, and they're a new person. And this is the concept of teshuvah, if you can undo, to try and undo that. And I think you're right, Vivian. It's, some people don't allow you to do that. And some people, therefore, there's two things that we're told. Meshaneh Shem and Meshaneh Makom. Meshaneh Makom, Meshaneh Mazal. Sometimes you have to move places to get to change that, because the people where you are originally won't allow you to forget the things that you've done. So I think that's a very important point that you raise, and we should all make an effort to allow people to do teshuva, to allow people to undo reputations that they have, which might not be good reputations. And the second point that you make, of a good name being the most important, of course, that's a pasuk from Mishlei, Tov Shem Mishem En Tov, a good name is better than good oil. In other words, it's the greatest thing that you can have. And that Tov Shem Mishem En Tov is exactly the pasuk that I put on my father's matzeva.
Okay, I think we'll call it a day or an evening. Rabbi Johnny Lieberman, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Kept everybody's attention and raised some very interesting questions, and in particular relating between medieval times and modern times. That's something I think that people in Israel try to do all the time, is to try and draw inspiration for what happened in the past in order to try and drive us forward and face our present challenges. And that's something that we all have to deal with the whole time. That's the essence of the modern state of Israel. Okay, Shavua Tov, Gemar Chatima Tova Lekulam. And maybe we can do some more of these joint programs between our two communities. You know, we're both in the same city. We don't have a lot in common between us. A lot of us know each other from the communities, and maybe we should really consider doing something together in the future as well.
I think that's a great idea. You and I should get our heads together and try and get some joint programs, and hopefully try and get some joint programs in person eventually, in due course, Bezrat Hashem, when we can get over this current crisis. Everybody should stay well, have a meaningful and successful and easy Yom Kippur, and let's come out of it the other side inspired for a wonderful year ahead. Shavua Tov, Gemar Chatima Tova to everybody.
Chatima Tova.
Wonderful, wonderful evening. Very, very good. Tada, Rabbi Lieberman.
Yes, Gemar Chatima Tova.
Thanks, Johnny. Bye.
Johnny, it was great. Thank you.
Chatima Tova Lekulam. May we all be inspired by this year.
Yes, thanks, Johnny. Very nice indeed.